putting us in social media with the hashtag BLS Amit, Women Leading, and at Lamb Theater. So my name is Schaefer Mazo. I'm one of the steering committee members here, and it's my amazing honor to introduce this panel. I am a proud Wellesley alum, former ACT staff member and current subscriber, and I have to say that I was thrilled to bring these two transformative progressive institutions together for this project. There's a long, hilarious history about how this work got done. Well, hilarious, tear-jerking, it's all kinds of but the call to action was for an RFP for a funder that said, we want ideas to change the world. And Ellen and Carrie Perloff said, why don't we find out why there aren't more women leaders in theater? And we said, okay, I don't know how to find that out. We don't know the reasons. Maybe we should get some research people involved. And originally they were thinking of going to someplace like Stanford or someplace local in the Bay Area, and I said, I think you need to look at Wellesley. And I think, you know, there were voices that said, nah, we don't need to, I've got connections, it's fine, Stanford time. And I said, no, do me a favor, please. And it said, do this link to this website, the Wellesley Centers for Women, and I just want you to think about it over here. And next day, the decision was made, we were gonna ask Wellesley to do this. Yes, Wellesley's the perfect fit. And we reached out to Wellesley, and they wrote back immediately and said, yes, we want to do this. So, this has been a Herculean effort, and the results, I think, speak for themselves, what's happening in the field. So, now let me introduce your panel. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't even announce the plenary session is called Leadership Shifts from Wellesley Report to Executive Search. Oh, so we have joining us today Emeka Abed. Who's the Assistant Managing Director at Alliance Theater, and she's co-chair of the Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee, and also chairs the Mentorship Subcommittee at LORD's Equity, Diversity, and Inclusivity Initiative. Then we have Annika Cedar. Annika is Research Associate at the Wellesley Center for Women, working on projects ranging from women's leadership to adolescent development, to same-sex marriage, to racial and ethnic identity, and then there's this. Helped do this. Jenna DJ is the VP of Art at Art, is a Vice President of Arts Consulting Group, with experience in cultural organization leadership and programming and strategic planning. She was at Chicago's legendary Second City for 12 years, part of that time as managing producer, and has co-produced more than 20 critically and commercially successful shows. Sheila Hennessy is principal at the Koya Leadership Partners, with focus on West Coast region, with experience spanning the full spectrum of the recruitment lifecycle. Her clients include Oregon Shakespeare Festival, Baltimore Symphony, and the Smithsonian, among many, many others. She's also a professional actress, both on stage and screen. And she's a board member at Laguna Playhouse. Dr. Joan Lancourt is the founder of the Greater Boston Theater Board Leaders Group, and has been board chair at Underground Railway and Company One Theater in Boston. She has over 30 years' experience managing and consulting to a variety of local and global organizations in a variety of industries and sectors. And she's also the co-author of Intentional Revolutions, a 7-point strategy for transforming organizations. Mm-hmm. Laura Penn is executive director at SDC. After 25-year career in LORD management. She's currently forging partnerships and focusing on improving unions' communications and expanding its reach and scope. Laura is a member of Broadway Coalition of Unions and Guilds, a member of the Tony Administration Committee, and Facehold Studio Theater Lab. serves on the committee for Broadway Salutes. And our moderator today is Ellen Richard, executive director at Laguna Playhouse. She's led some of America's most prestigious theaters, including the Roundabout Theater, Second Stage Theater, ACT. She has 6 Tony Awards to her name. She has built theaters on both coasts of this country. More than I knew, more than I've probably been in. And she commissioned this Women's Leadership in Residential Theater study from the Wellesley Centers for Women. And this is my personal shout out to Ellen. Ellen started this work. Ellen sat down with the numbers and said, I'm gonna see what the actual numbers of gender parity look like, and she did. And that's why we're here today. Ellen has been the most persistent advocate for this work from its beginning, and thank you so much for starting this. Woo!
Out there doing the kinds of things that translate to the search we're looking for. And I was telling Ellen, we think of it in particular buckets, you know, who's doing exactly this job already, but who's doing other things that are transferable? Similar organizations, but a little bit outside the box. We try to think pretty expansively. So we try to be proactive in reaching out to you. If a search firm reaches out to you, even if you have no interest in the position, respond. You know, send an email back, say, yeah, I'll have a phone call, and give referrals if you can. You want to start making those relationships. Build the relationship with the recruiters. Because we, as Jenna said, we want to get to know you. And for every particular search, we're going to have limited time. It may be a quick phone call. But at least we'll get to know each other. You'll be on our radar. You'll learn something about the process and how we work. And we'll maintain that relationship and build it over time. We work a lot at different levels of organizations. We do lots of different kinds of functional searches. So we really like to get to know emerging leaders and follow their careers so that we know when they're ready for that next step. So don't hesitate to, you know, take the call, have a conversation, get acquainted. You can also figure out who are the search firms that are working in this field. We're not one of the ones that are doing all the theater searches. I hope that'll change, because I think there's a lot we can bring to it in terms of our process and how we work. But who else is working in the nonprofit space? We focus, Koya focuses only on the nonprofit sector, so it's not just theater, it's not just arts, it's other organizations as well, but it's all mission focused. So find out who those firms are, and if you can sign up for their updates, their newsletters, do that and start following what they're doing, and if you see a search that is of interest, you can be proactive in reaching out to the recruiters who are working on that.
Inika, do you want to give us, for those who haven't read the study or the summary, some of the top level findings from the study?
Sure, yeah. I'm going to stand up because I don't see you. I said this during lunch, and I used the word pipeline, but I used to talk the word sprinkling system.
Irrigation
system. Thank you. The irrigation, I love that term. So I'm looking at the irrigation system. When we did the study, people said, oh, it's a pipeline issue. No. Here's the proof, and I want us to have a picture. Here's your... Anyway.
We're going to have a picture right at the end of this session.
Yes, that's what we need. So, I prepared notes because that's how I am. I don't ad-lib easily. So, I'm going to go through them. But they will be going through the results of our study, hopefully just about 10 minutes. I did bring copies, they're on the floor over there, of our executive summary. If you haven't seen it yet, please take one. If we run out, it's on our website. If you want to read 200 pages, that's on our website too, but that's how long it took us to come together. So Ellen, Carrie, Schaefer, Bethany Heron, lots of people in this room who gave us interviews, resumes, filled out surveys, talked to us again and again and again. Thank you for letting us do this. I have never done a study on a population like this, where you come into the room, it's a love fest from minute one. I so adore that. Also, I've never been asked to go back a year after a study's been done to talk about what the industry is doing about what we found. That doesn't happen. So kudos to all of you. Into the nitty-gritty. So what I'm going to highlight are five takeaway themes that we found through sifting through 1,000 surveys from SEC membership, a lot of millennials to get. 333 surveys from people in high-level executive leadership. 100 in-person interviews, what will be phone interviews, very intense and deep. And 300 bios from people like you all over the field. We mostly focused on the Lord Theaters because that was what we were asked to do. And so our question was, why are there so few women in these regional theaters? Five themes came up. The first one, and that really stood out, if you want to make it into that leadership, you have to gain the trust and the familiarity to get there, the trust of the industry. So how did we find that? We looked at advantages for men to get into leadership and advantages for women to get into leadership. And I used to have a slide, I didn't bring slides because it's too much. But there are advantages on one side for the men, and these are them. Men, especially white men, fit the theater leader stereotype. Right? So there's 68% versus, and got promoted from a lower budget theater to a higher budget theater, 9% of women got promoted. 35%, 9%. Big difference. Trust and potential. And we also found that women often found their own theaters. They don't get hired necessarily, but they found their theaters. And they have a large, it's mostly women who have that experience. There's a large number of women who do that. But that the value that that experience has is seen in a man's CV, but it's not seen in a woman's CV. And that also came through in our results. So those were the three kind of pushes that a man can enjoy. into getting into that leadership position. So let's look at what benefits a woman. How does she get that leadership? We found actually a statistically significant difference. And judging by our sample size, you know, we had 74 theaters. It's actually really hard to find statistically significant differences if you only deal with 74 people, or what comes through AD and ED versus 13%, 40% women versus 13% men. That was a very important finding. But that's where it stops for women. So for men, there are three advantages. For women, there's one thing. And that's the promotion. That's the familiarity of that woman and the trust in her skills because she is a known factor that got her bumped into the leadership. All right, so that was trust and familiarity, kind of more like the theoretical looking at our data. Secondly, I want to talk about work-life balance. And this is becoming my pet peeve because I really would like to do a second project looking at this. How do you survive in this theater industry, right? I don't want to just talk about childcare. I also want to talk about caregiving for other family members. We are a little bit of a sandwich generation where we don't just have children, but we have parents who are aging who need our care. In our society, this falls on the women's shoulders. No matter how many men are stepping up, kudos to them, but there is lots of research out there, it's not my research, but we can find it if you would like it, that shows that women are still bearing that brunt in our society. So when you come into this field, which is very demanding, you have to go travel, you have to work long hours, I heard this over and over again, how do you combine that with your children or with caring for somebody else? There's no support for it, there's no financial support, you probably don't make enough money to even get into a high quality childcare. So if you know how to get money for that project, come and talk to me because I want to do that project. I think it's a next action step we can take to really address this issue. I know there are people in this room who have benefited from ways that theaters, you know, made it work for you. What are those ways? Let's bring it all together. Let's inform each other. And let that be like a national, maybe our next conference we can talk about that if we have the data by then. So somebody said, when we found that women were not willing to talk about their child care issues, somebody said, women are taught not to talk about it because it's a liability. You won't get the job if they know that you're taking care of somebody. This was about children, but again, it can translate to taking care of other people. So let's work on that. Mentorship, relationships, you've talked about this. Mentorship is crucial. I don't have to talk about this in this room. You are doing it here. It's in action. I so admire that. Who is your best mentor? The best mentor is someone who can speak to your strengths, who gets to know you inside and out. It's a two-way relationship also. If you want to learn about mentorship, listen to the live streaming HowlRound production of our last year, August? Mm-hmm. San Francisco, Sivas Rico sat on the stage and talked about mentorship in ways that are really critical. Mm-hmm. Anyway, do that. A mentor is also somebody who can make those connections for you. That's important. But if you have a mentor who looks like you, who has been through stuff like you are going through, that is really critical. There are fewer of those for women, and there are even fewer of those for people of color. So let's work on that. It's a very, very, very big barrier, especially for people of color, especially, because there are no women of color in leadership. Zero. Except for one person who, as we talked earlier, not many people know that she's a person of color. So let's talk about that. Let's put that in a brave space conversation. So what do you actually need on that resume? So from looking at resumes, from talking to people, from the surveys that we did for artists, if you want to become an artistic director, this is the list. Go and direct widely across the country. You know, do that travel, very important. Have a command of public speaking and relationship building. Those are important skills for fundraising, which an artistic director does have to be involved in. And lastly, get production skills. It's very crucial, especially for women, to get those production skills on their resume to get to the top. On the executive side, so the ED side, I'm sorry if we use these acronyms and that's not what you do in the field. There are three important top skills and accomplishments. Board relations, number one, off the top. Strategic planning, try to learn it, understand it, and of course, fundraising skills. But fourth, also an important skill, it's not quite up there with the other three, but cross-departmental expertise is that word that people use. And I've heard people talk about it in other sessions where you don't just dip your toe in some other department and listen to the rumors, but you really get in there and understand and know what it's about so you can talk about it when you are that leader. Because as the leader, you need to be able to understand all of that. That was mentorship. Affordability, I've talked to some people about here already today. None of you here are getting rich. This is not a lucrative field. And a lot of you, especially the younger generations, are coming in with enormous amounts of debt. Especially people who go to grad school. Grad school is really expensive. Are you going to make it back? How do you balance it out? A very important element for the field to really start addressing. Very important. And last but not least, culture fit. And Michelle, you talked about this earlier today, and I really appreciated that. When you bring in a non-traditional leader, is your theater ready for that person? Whether it's a person of color, whether it's a woman, whether it's just somebody who looks different, whatever their diversity aspects are, compared to your theater. You need to work on your theater first before you bring your theater. You know this already, but the culture really needs to embrace that person. Otherwise, she is going to fail. And failing as a woman is a very public thing, as you know. So we need to be there. The dominant culture needs to move to a different space. We need to give a person who is a different leader the actual formal authority to be a leader. We need to support that person throughout everything. You know, the audience, the board, everybody needs to support that. So, that was my, hopefully not too long, spiel. If you want to talk work-life balance, I'm all ears, please. That's my next step. Thank you.
Membership of those full members, which are those filing contracts, and Lord Theaters, we have agreements with Lord Theaters, so they hire almost exclusively SDC members, 30% women, 70% men. Now, I have had a couple of artistic directors call me to say, what's the membership? What's the ratio in the membership? And I say, 30. They say, oh, well, then we're doing okay. I'm like, no, actually, because you can't become a member of SDC unless you are working. So there's the, you know, it's not really a question of the chicken or the egg, because you have to, because you have to have a job before you become a member. So there's an interplay there. We also know that in our associate membership pool, which does not require filing contracts, it's 50-50. So women drop off as soon as the professional work starts. You know, there are some pretty, the stats get pretty terrifying when you start to break it down to the larger theaters and the smaller theaters, women of color, where, you know, the needle has not moved. It's something like 4% of the contracts in Lord Theaters every year go to women of color.
4%?
Yes. Yeah. It's not good. It's also true older women. Men over 60 get 11% of the contracts, and more women over 60 get about 3%. So the numbers are not great. And we, of course, have been, you know, working both within our organization, because although you have to file contracts to become a member, we also recognize that the organization itself has to be open to not being quite so male-dominated, not being quite so white-dominated, so that we can push the industry to be more diverse. We have to have a culture within the organization that's prepared to embrace a more diverse workforce. So we're working on kind of all fronts simultaneously. But yeah, it's... And as for childcare, I just want to say, I can say it out loud, I can't stay tonight because I have to go home. I got to go take care of my daughter. So I wish I was having dinner with you.
Joan, you are going to be hosting a convening of board leaders to talk about equity.
Diversity and inclusion.
Yes.
What are you hoping for?
I think to what you said about...
Yeah, sorry.
What you had said about we have to work on the organization before they're ready to do something different, and I think that's really true of the boards. I had started a group of board chairs of the mid-sized theaters in Boston, and we were meeting every 6 or 7 weeks for almost a year. We finally decided that we needed to bring the boards together to look at some of the issues that all of the theaters were facing. In Boston, the demographics have changed significantly. It's now a majority people of color city, and we looked around, and so some of the things we were doing on that day were looking at the data and the demographics, and people looked around the room, and with one exception, all of the boards were white. And so they commented on it, and it took about a year and a half more to get the boards to agree that, gee, we really need to do something about this. And, you know, I could push just so much, and then I have to sort of let it gel. They finally decided, okay, we're going to have another convening. We put together a panel of community leaders from the communities of color in Boston. And the question that we asked them was, what do the boards need to do in order to get people of color to be on the board? And everybody said, well, we've tried and we haven't had any, you know, real success. What do we need to do? And without exception, the panel said, we never see you in the community, so why would we want to be on your board? And so that was a like, oh my God. And within the panel presentations, they of course also talked about the issue of the tokenism. Is it, you know, check the box, we have one person of color on the board. The cultures need to change. The whole issue of unconscious bias, white privilege, you know, all the labels that are floating around. And so it was a lot for them, for the board people, to absorb. We finally, after that session, more, you know, sort of talking and working and thinking, put together another planning committee, and decided we would have another convening, and we thought, what do we need to do to help the boards think about how to change. And so one of the people on the planning committee is a friend of Bill Rausch at Oregon Shakespeare Festival. And so we called him and said, would you come and work with the group to talk about your experience? We thought if we can show, even though they're a big theater and these are smaller theaters, some of the lessons learned will be applicable. And so he is coming to work on, you know, what they learned at Oregon Shakespeare Festival, how they have dealt with some of the unconscious bias issues. And so we are, you know, having that session at the beginning of December. We're looking to get some coaching for the boards from December through to the spring, because then they've got to go back to their boards and work on some of these issues. And to then have a spring convening, I've spoken with Sima Sueko at Arena Stage. She has a fabulous community engagement model, consensus organizing, she calls it, that I've seen and had talked to her about. I'm trained as a community organizer, so when I saw it, I went, ah, this is fabulous. And so the whole issue, you know, that the panel had raised about we never see you in the community, I think that model can help, and I believe that the at least in the smaller theaters, that board members need to be some of the people going out into the communities and building relationships. I had worked in a program at the Kennedy School where we used a board development model that really said it's not that we ask too much of our boards, we ask too little of them. And the boards are just tired of being check writers and cheerleaders. And if we don't give them something more substantive to wrestle with, then the behaviors we see are largely a result of their board. And I had written a series at in HowlRound when I first went on a board, interviewing some interesting theaters around the country to talk to their board chairs about what they were doing and see what were best practices. And they were involving boards in the real core issues of the future of the theaters. In the model we used, it's called generative thinking, and that the boards need to be involved early in that process, not after the staff has framed the issue and written the plan and then presents it to the board for a rubber stamp. So those are some of the things that we're hoping, you know, that this infrastructure that we're creating will help boards. This is really hard work, and it's very threatening to a lot of people, but it has to happen. We can't, you know, they're 501c3s. They're supposed to be serving the whole community, not just the upper middle class white community. And so how do we... how do we help people, you know, of goodwill, but some of them don't know what to do, some of them are scared, some of them are really ready to do. So this infrastructure, I hope, will help them move forward.
Great. And one of the things you talked about was trust and familiarity. And even though I know we didn't look at this in the study, I've been thinking more about who has these jobs. And I noticed that there's as many gay men in running board theaters as there are women. And there's just one lesbian, and I think four people of color. So it's sort of like the tribe, I feel like there's tribes. I also feel like there's a Yale tribe out there. And how do any of you have suggestions around how to navigate that? I mean, if you're not a gay man, how do you break into that world and these influencers? Or you didn't go to Yale.
I did go to Yale.
I know you
did. So this one must be for you.
Well, so I can talk about Yale specifically, and then I can talk also about sort of what Lort is doing. So Yale and some other training programs are taking this work really seriously, looking at who is, you know, understanding that training is a big part of the path to leadership. It doesn't have to be, but it is for a lot of leaders in our industry. So I think Yale School of Drama is really taking that seriously. They're looking at who's coming in, who's teaching it, breaking down, what are the classics that we hold as the pillars of our field, doing deep work. They're partnering with Carmen Morgan and Art Equity to do a lot of that work. There are more experts in the room probably that can speak to what that is, but part of it is acknowledging that there are systems of privilege and white supremacy and that are embedded in a lot of what has led us to the moment that we are right now in the field that we have. So Lort, I would like to think everyone knows what it is, but I don't want to make that assumption. So Lort, League of Resident Theaters, is a collective bargaining unit and a trade association of regional nonprofit professional theaters. There's 74 members now, and so you can imagine that within that number, there is quite a range of types of theaters, sizes of theaters, geography, cities, let alone the individuals that make up that group. 3 years ago, Lort decided to really take their take diversity seriously, and so they had a diversity statement, which has continued to sort of grow and evolve over those last 3 years. So I've been working for Lort Theaters for just the last couple of years, and so I sort of take for granted that that is an important value that Lort has, but it's really only been at the forefront for the last few years. So some of the things that we're doing now, and again, we're very much trying to think holistically. So in the conversation about executive leadership, understanding, yes, that the organizations need to prepare to support those leaders too, so that we're not bringing in people that are set up to fail also. So just to sort of rattle off some things. So thinking about the organizations and also the trajectory of leadership, we have a recruitment subcommittee within our Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion initiative, and are looking at hiring practices, looking at recruitment practices or lack thereof. So one specific thing, so Lort meets twice a year. Lort leaders meet in different cities where we have member theaters. And we've started a couple years ago doing what we're calling ambassador panels. So we, in these different cities, have a panel of Lort leaders and bring in high school and college students from that area to talk about careers in the arts, to give them a networking opportunity, and then we also collect their email addresses so that we can follow up with them about open job opportunities that we have. We did their website recently, and we have a centralized resource of the job opportunities and internships and fellowships at Lort Theaters. So taking that barrier down of having to know what the theaters are and know, where they exist and go to each different website, now you can just go to lort.org and look up everything in one place. And then we're also looking at retention. We're starting to look at, again, a lot of theaters have very diverse interns, and how do we actually create job opportunities for them to keep them in the field and to allow them to continue to progress. So one thing that's new, Schaefer mentioned chairing our mentorship and professional development subcommittee. And this I'm new to this as of a few months ago because I was like, I wanna dig into it. So we're looking at in that career trajectory, and this actually really came directly out of the Wellesley study. What are the barriers to from people that are in manager levels of some sort to getting to that executive leadership position? And so there's a number of us that are in these sort of like next in line type positions, and really wanted to make sure that our voices were heard. So it wasn't just the people who have been comfortably in the industry in those executive leadership positions for 30 years saying, here's what we think you need. It's us sort of saying, here's what we're looking for. And so one thing with the especially in regards to women, the trust and familiarity piece of it being so important, looking at setting up, and we haven't done this yet, but looking at setting up a sponsorship, which is sort of more than just a mentor, right? Sponsor is this advocate who can speak on your behalf. Setting up that program where it connects leaders that want to have something to give and want to be a sponsor with folks that are looking for sponsors, and looking inter-organizationally so that you're making those connections, right? It's not just that you have the five people within your organization that know who you are and know how wonderful you are, but starting to spider that out. And we're also looking at these executive hiring opportunities. So with every open position in a LORT theater, there is a letter that goes to the remaining executive partner. So if we're hiring an artistic director, the letter will go to the remaining managing director, as well as either the chair of the search committee or the chair of the board of directors. And it lets them know that equity, diversity, and inclusion is a very important value within our constituency, and that this is an opportunity to take that really seriously. We cannot tell them who to hire or what to do, but we make it clear that we expect for every open position that they interview in person a diverse and qualified pool of applicants. And I've also just been told this last week that saying diverse and qualified makes it sound like you assume that if it's diverse, they're not qualified. So I'm reworking my language too. And so that just reinforces what we expect. The Rooney Rule, raise your hand if you're familiar with the Rooney Rule. Okay, so this was something that the NFL instituted a number of years ago. They noticed their head coaches in the NFL, and if I say the wrong word, it's because I don't know much about football, that the head coaches were all white. And so someone was named Rooney, and his rule was that, purely by interviewing people of color for those head coach positions, they increased the diversity in who was hired. So again, it's not saying you must hire this person. It's saying you must get to that in-person interview, that final round interview, you must have a diverse pool. So one thing just to note too, I think in the Wellesley study, it focuses on women. It also mentions people of color, and there's a lack of all of those groups of people. And you know, there are some different dynamics as you know, if it's a gender, it pulls out the glass ceiling. It also notes that there is, for people of color, it's more than just a glass ceiling. So we're really looking at all of that. And then just to also call out, I don't think the study really talked about folks that are non-binary. And so that's something there's just, I think, a lack of data about, but trying to be inclusive and considering that as well. And when we're thinking of underrepresented groups, right now we're really focused on women and people of color, but obviously there are other underrepresented groups in leadership as well. And so we are tracking not only who's getting hired into these open positions, but also who is being interviewed. And so since we've been tracking this within LORT for the last few years, There have been 31 searches. 9 women were hired of that 31, and 22 men, and 1 person of color.
Whoa.
And so we are at the point now where we are also starting to speak with those organizations, find out a little bit more. What we want to do is to also speak to women and people of color that are interviewed for those positions and not hired. The tricky part is we don't know who they are unless they step forward. So if any of you in the room represent those, we would love to be able to speak with you. And what am I forgetting? And then we're also working, we have a newly formed Advancement and Collective Action Subcommittee that is working with Equity, with SDC, with USA, because those unions are also really working to diversify the artists in the pool so that we're not hiring that, I don't know, 4% of people of color as directors. So that is sort of work that is starting to happen. So it's important work, it's hard work, and it takes sort of coming at it from all these different angles. Thank you.
You mentioned the Rooney Rule, and I like the Rooney Rule because it was imposed upon the NFL. They had to follow it. We don't have that in Lord. We just have to assume everybody's going to be a good citizen.
Yeah.
We have to assume everybody's going to bring in a diverse group of people. And one of the things I thought about is, and I'm quite sure maybe somebody else could take this up, you know, can we get the NEA, can we get the Schubert Foundation, can we get the Irvine Foundation, or a local funder to say, on an application, last time you had a leadership search, who did you, not specifically who, but what were the demographics of who you interviewed? Who did you bring in? I think we need some teeth, because I think a lot of people aren't good citizens, personally. And then everybody justifies, there's no consequences. Everybody, every board will say, well, we hired the best person for our theater. Enough places don't open this search to the field, they just promote from within. So what does that do to other candidates? You're not given that opportunity. Any you have any thoughts about that?
Actually, I have something that is so relevant, and also what you're saying about boards.
Do you mind standing up,
John? Oh, sure, I forgot, sorry. that our conversation now, when we go in and talk with search committees, our conversation is now that diversity is a bullet point. It is a part of it. It is, the question used to be, from what I understand, is diversity important to you in this search? Which like makes my, you makes me twitch, because you're like, how is that even a question? It's a priority. And so it's been very interesting working with a bunch of different clients. Some folks are already and ready, running and gunning for that, and others, their reaction to that is panic. A lot of times it's panic because they're going to have to go to their board, and the perception is that it will slow down the process. Because you don't just serve up your first 25 applicants who they are, the best applicants. You actually have to recruit in this way. You have to do it with purpose. It has to be intentional. You have to seek them out. And a lot of times we're going in to fill position, and already it's causing an upset in the pH of the community and or the organization or both, and they kind of want to get it done. They don't want to linger on this, and they want to move forward. And we're really having to be disciplined ourselves. We'd like to get it done too. We only have that much time. But to say, we often will do research on the organization and tell them what their diversity record looks like, which is also a fun conversation. Not that fun conversation. But it really helps them understand that, like, it's there. That information is actually also available to people to see, are you being a good citizen? Are you not being a good citizen? Especially our company, Arts Consulting Group, we work in a lot of mid-markets. And so there's been a lot of the same, not that it's not in large markets, there's a lot of the same people, and they're switching around from one nonprofit to the next, and it's the same 25 suspects. Not that they're not awesome, but where are all of these people? And so
we're
having
They're here. I know.
So it is on us to reach out and also make ourselves known, but also these organizations, whether you use a search firm or not, to do this, to make themselves known and the mentorship as well, because they're out there, and that's lazy, in my opinion. So we're trying to push them to in the search community.
I wanted to pick up on Ellen's point about getting other kinds of organizations involved. We work for lots of different kinds of arts organizations, public commissions, arts councils. We're seeing a lot more focus on diversity, perhaps in other kinds of organizations and the arts world in general, than perhaps you're seeing in the theater, which is really, really interesting. We're doing, you know, the executive director for the LA County Arts Commission. Mm-hmm. A key part of that search is, or that position, is there's a new cultural equity initiative in LA County. So in approaching that search, it's critical that we focus on bringing them a diverse pool of candidates. And that's the case with most of the arts-related searches we're doing. We as a firm have an internal metric about diversity. We're judged based on how diverse our candidates are. So we use it as an internal metric. We expect it of our clients, and we encourage them to do that, and they often come to us for that reason. So it's just really interesting as you think about broadening the conversation. There's more progress happening than you may know. You know, in the arts organizations as a whole, with funders, grant makers, this topic is alive and well. And we're even seeing searches that are restarted because the first time around there wasn't enough of a focus on diversity. And then they started again after doing a broader stakeholder involvement conversation. So I think that's a really great recommendation. Who else is doing this, and who can we involve and partner with?
Yeah, I just want to say that I'm Martha Richards from Women Arts. So we've done studies, or have published on our site, studies of a lot of different art forms. Women in opera are facing exactly the same problem as we are. Women in dance, women in classical music. I mean, so I would say, in terms of all the mainstream major arts organizations, women are facing the exact same barriers. It may be in a government job, like a county commission job, it's going to be different because there's taxpayer money involved and it should be represented in the population. But I think the mainstream arts organizations, I would not say, agree with you, that we're seeing more overall progress.
John? There was an article in the New York Times a few months ago, Bill de Blasio told the, I think it was the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Opera, that if they didn't diversify their boards, no more city money. Mm-hmm. Wow. So that's a real However, the most recent study by BoardSource of the percent of people of color on boards was very disturbing because it has actually gone down in the last 2 years. So there, they've been holding webinars and all kinds of stuff to really dig into why and what needs to be done, you know, to get the number back up. But it seemed to me that things like de Blasio saying something like that will certainly have some kind of an impact.
Getting back a little bit to how you get the job and some of those roadblocks, and more, you're meeting with some of your membership, talking to them about becoming artistic directors.
Yes, one of the things, as my perspective is my perspective, having run theaters and worked in other regional theaters prior to coming to the union, when I got there about 10 years ago, it seemed to me that there was a subset of the membership, many of them women, freelance artists who, you know, I don't want to be an artistic director because I'll never get hired, or those jobs seem terrible, or, you know, it just wasn't appealing. And I thought, you know, these are extraordinarily brilliant artists that should be running our theaters. And so what is that about? And how can we sort of begin to engage in a discussion with them about why they're choosing or not choosing? And so we have an informal program through our foundation on artistic leadership, where we bring together freelance artists, those who have not run institutions and have not worked in institutions of any size. So we don't have anybody in the room who's like, well, when I did that, it didn't work. So it's not, it's really sort of a singular point of view, the freelance artist and artistic leadership, to talk about what these jobs are and aren't, to talk about transferable skills, to demystify the nature of the work, to talk about why folks think they don't want to be an artistic director or what might be interesting about it. And it's really fascinating, because part of the challenge in bringing a more diverse or bringing women into these positions is they haven't had these positions, so they don't have the experience. So they can't get the position, but they haven't had the position. So beginning to try to figure out how to help break down some of those barriers. So we we talk about fundraising as storytelling. All of a sudden it's like, that's what it is? It starts to make sense for folks. Personnel management, like the rehearsal room. How do you manage a group company of actors? That's how you manage it. I mean, it multiplies, but it's the same dynamic. Maybe more complicated in some rehearsal halls, right? So, budget. When was the last time your first, concept of a physical production came in over budget? And then how did you get it within the constraints of a budget? Now you have to operationalize that for a whole organization, but you know how to manage a budget. So it begins to sort of break down some of those things that might cause, and again, particularly women, to go into these, and if they do go into an interview or talk to a search firm, they're like, yeah, well, but I don't really know how to do that. So they can go, well, actually, I do know how to budget.
Yeah.
And here's the complexity of the productions that I've, run budgets on and brought in successfully, solid products on time, on budget. So it's been, and it's interesting to see folks begin to land some jobs. It's not a, it's not a placement program. It's not a, we have managing and artistic directors come in and talk to folks about their experience, some of the, some of the silverback Lord managers and artistic directors. It's helpful because they also learn, right? They also exchange sort of, well, this is what your job looks like. Well, it's sort of like that. Oh, maybe it shouldn't be like that. And how do they begin to open up the culture of the organizations they're leading by nature, that they've just sat in a room with 18 freelance, mid-career artists that don't look like anybody in their organization. Mm-hmm. So, we'll see. It's interesting to try to figure out how do you solve for this? I love these kinds of gatherings, and I love to just go back and do my work, like the incremental little pieces we can take and begin to sort of forge some change. And I like to think that's one of the things we're doing that has some. Yes?
What's the name of this? Is this a specific network or organization you're describing?
No, it's just, it's a program we do informally. It's not on any schedule. You don't, I mean, I'd love to get it funded. I know, everybody's like, wait, I want to come. I know, David's going to kill me, the director of organization. This is our little secret. I think I just let it out on HowlRound. We'd love to be able to do this, but it's not funded, and it's like, it's something we've been sort of playing with the last few years, but I think there's something in there about a safe space to talk about what this work is and, build confidence.
I think two things. I think one, be great if it could be on a webinar or a live stream so that people around the country can get in on that conversation.
Uh-huh.
And two, I think you're right. I think women freelance directors will undersell themselves, in terms of what they've actually been doing. But I also think it's also changing the paradigm with the theaters and the search committees, it's for them to realize, oh, that person has, because women have been leading, just maybe leading a rehearsal room, or producing a festival, or running an MFA program, or, women have been leading this, so that it's trying to also help the theaters understand how that skill set actually can translate quite easily. Because if you've been running anything as a woman, you figured a whole lot of stuff out.
Yeah.
I just wanted to jump in. If you do want to read those 200 pages, we actually have data, because we asked the question, why do you not want to be an artistic director to your sample? So we surveyed the director part of the SDC membership, and about 1,000 people returned those surveys. And the top one reason people don't want to be an artistic director if they're in a directorship is fundraising. And in what I said before, fundraising is a task that you need to be involved in as an artistic director, but it has two components, right? It's the relationship building, and it's the speaking to your mission and putting that together. So the public speaking of your mission, and that, there are two tasks that all of you already master, because you wouldn't be here if you couldn't fill out that application. You can already talk about your personal mission, and you already are here building those relationships. So what you're doing in that room, you, each of you, can do in your theater with your mentor, whoever is there with you, hopefully in your theater or outside your theater, and really focus on and ask that question, how can I apply what I already know to fundraising? And get it on your resume. Even if you didn't raise a gazillion dollars with that skill, you know, you can probably do something with those skills. Get in there and raise $100. And there, you have done fundraising.
I also love what Lisa was saying about re-educating boards and search committees. Mm-hmm. The thing that really jumped out at me is that they want a resume that shows that the woman has directed around the country. Mm-hmm. And I've talked to several women directors who, they're equal age of a male partner, they have children. The male peer also has children, but he has a wife that is staying home to take care of the kids. So he can travel around and get that resume. I don't get why that makes you a better director, because you're going to travel around. Knows how to build deep relationships in the community, right? So that whole criteria, I think, needs to go.
Blow open the idea that a woman can only direct a play by a woman, or that a black person can only direct a play about the Black experience, so I do think it's important that the places in place are directed by people who understand. I am as qualified to direct Shakespeare or Austin as I am to direct August Wilson, and that we have to blow open those doors if we really want to see women and women of color reach past, you know, mid-management in our field. And I think that teams are talking about it and acknowledging that there are lots of systems and stops built into the bias of the way our organizations work, we're never going to be able to solve the problem.
I'm the associate artistic director for 10 years, and there's nothing to cultivate us to go off. Mm-hmm. And I feel like, to your point, a lot of the work, none of the recognition, the invisibility of like everything that you're doing to make everyone else look good, so that then when you do go before a search committee, you don't have a lot, I mean, you can talk about everything, but you don't have a lot of credit for what it is that you're doing. So I would say that I think it's great that we're having all of these conversations about how we cultivate young voices, how we cultivate people of color, bring your interns up through, get them jobs. But then there are those of us who are sitting there watching everybody else move up.
Yeah.
It's so important. It's so important to create opportunity. But then we just sit there going, okay, so I guess I die as an AA.
You know? Let me just say, our program is not for young directors. So it's not. It's for mid-career, this conversation. It is for mid-career. And in fact, when a lot of this conversation started happening with Lord and Rooney Rule and TCG and Women's Day, and all that, there was that sort of cacophony of stuff coming at all of us. There was some sense that we at SDC should start a high school program. And I was like, stop. Stop. We are not starting a high school program. Here's the problem. I mean, and as much as, listen, I am in awe of Liz Diamond and have been for some 25 years. And I speak every year to the graduate students from the directing program at Yale. And it's a diverse group. And I wonder where the hell they're going to work. And we've got a whole group of folks, 35 to 50, women and skilled artists of color who cannot sustain their lives and are completely capable of leadership roles and more directing gigs. Okay? So that's who we've got to figure out before. I mean, somebody should do a high school program. I'm not saying nobody should deal with high school, but this is to the question about pipeline. This is not that there's not enough women and artists of color, at least from the, I mean, I can speak most specifically from the directors segment, that are capable, more than capable, and brilliantly positioned to take these roles. Everybody wants to think we've got to help those college programs recruit better. No, they're doing great. We got to make sure those folks have work.
There was a question
right here.
So I have a question, two related things about Lord. One is, I just wanted to know the statistics about the searches when he was hired. How many years did that cover? And I wondered if you noticed a shift before and after the election, because I think it doesn't really know what I have. So that's one part. And then the other part was, Joseph Hodge wrote a piece for American Theater where he said that Lord considered and rejected a formal commitment to the Rooney Rule. Mm-hmm. And I found that really actually quite shocking, because I think I've heard of that mentioned as a potential solution for as long as I've been going to any kind of convening. Yeah. And I wonder if you can give us any insight. I actually found it quite depressing that it was rejected. And I wonder if you could give us any insight into why that formal commitment was rejected. I understand these are closed-room sessions.
Yeah, no, and I wasn't in whatever session that was decided. But what I know is that Lort has decided that they're not stating policies, it's a collective bargaining agreement. So we can hold each other accountable to, it's a collective bargaining unit. We can hold each other accountable to these collective bargaining agreements we have with the unions. Yeah. That is what our purpose is. And so when it reaches beyond that, we can, which we have done, we have all agreed to a thing, which is, includes doing Rooney Rule type searches, but we cannot mandate that everybody operates under that.
But could you not, like, I know that there are certain conditions that you have to close a theater in order to be able to hire a Lord Director, and like, couldn't adoption of the Rooney Rule be a precondition for being able to hire Lord Directors?
I think that Lord could decide that they wanted all of their theaters to abide by the Rooney Rule,
yeah,
and they decided not to, and just to say this is the best practices, and they're, as said, they're putting forward, you know, getting in contact with search firms, getting in contact with the remaining leader, but it was decided not to make this mandate.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And in terms of the statistics,
yeah,
I don't have those from your post-selection. We're just continuing to track it, but no, that's interesting. So you feel like anecdotally there's...
Yeah, I feel like I've noticed that. How many years did that cover? Three years.
I mean, I have to vary. The statistics from LORD as of December 2016 roster, there are 134 jobs because some positions were vacant, and sometimes there's dual leadership. 98 men, 36 women, and 4 diverse, 23 gay men, and 1 lesbian.
Wow.
And just, and one thing, again, so there's also like, there I find hope in some of the individual initiatives that some of the theaters are doing that I think are examples to other organizations, LORD or otherwise. So just to, one, I had a conversation with an artistic director of a LORD theater, and he is a white man, and he said, my charge is to prepare my organization so that when it comes time to replace, I'm not going anywhere, but when it comes time to replace me, they will hire someone that doesn't look like me. So if you're thinking of that lens, you're thinking about the board, right? Because the board has to be, they're the ones doing the search. You're thinking about the organization as a whole. You're thinking about the other people in the organization. You're thinking about the artwork that you do, you know? And so that helped me, you know, it's just one frame that one company has. You know, other examples of, like at the Guthrie and Joan Hodge saying, you know, we are not going to have any design team that is all white men. That should not be revolutionary to say, but they've committed to that and are actually, you know, putting their action where their words are. So, you know, we're, I think, and so I'm at the Alliance, and we have a staff equity, diversity, and inclusion committee. And so we are, you know, continuing to push our organization forward. And I'm sure with all of the people in the room, there are other examples of initiatives that they're taking that may not be mandated top down, but that are, you know, perhaps led ground up.
Yeah, we have a question. I just want to say, I informally track hiring at the top two, in the top two positions, so I've been tracking this for a few years now. And what I have found is that there's a lot of women in the secondary director roles, you know, director of development, director of education, and then you'll have sometimes a man or woman at the top of the organization, right, in each of those roles. But one thing that I have been finding in the last 7 or 8 years, since the economic downturn, is that organizations are, when the women leave, they're being replaced by men. And when, you know, when founding, women who founded companies, when they leave, they're all being replaced by men. This organization right here that we're standing on went through that a couple times. You know, so this one breaks my heart in particular, right? Because Tina Packer basically raised this place up out of nothing. And, you know, the minute she left, they replaced her with all men. Which, you know, love men. Really nice. They're all, you know, white men and white men. I think that I think part of the reason they do that is the board thing, and the boards are made up of people who come out of very traditional industries, like finance, right? And we need those people because they make money. And so they need to be on our boards. So there's
study from ACT, we had issues with Lori, with the Rooney Rule. That was not an idea that was brought from Lori. There, I was in a TCG room where there was an argumentative, argument from Joe Hodge, who stood up boldly and said, you have a group of people that are diversity committee of all white. Because there was not a person of color to be on a, in board to be on the committee.
Well, they rejected so, the two who were qualified.
Yes.
Two producers, two, yes. Joe Hodge and Tim Bond at the time offered to join the committee and were told that they could not because they were not managing diversity.
That's it. Thank you. So, you know, we have to look at the historicity of how we get to certain moments. For us, really, to step forward. So I would say, for SDC and Lord and the search committee, I mean, look, y'all, we are creative artists. We are women and those identifying as women. We represent a lot of different groups of people. In the next 10 years, do we need a formal search outside board of people to tell us what we need to do? And I'm not trying to take your job away. But seriously, think about it.
Yep.
We ask other people to help us do what we know how to do. We have communities of artists that work with us, and we don't go to them. We have to go to somebody else that has on a fancy suit to help us do something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they said it's a list going around on Facebook. We're all putting our names on the list. Oh, this is who I am. This is the position I'm in. You know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. And so I said to a friend who put it on Facebook, that's an amazing list. I'm going to put my name on the list. But why aren't some of these people on the list forming their own consulting company to really show, like, these are people that actually work with people of color and diverse groups of people. This is the talent pool that you need to come out with. Because, y'all, we're at critical times. Our field is not growing. Our field is not growing because the leadership is not reflective of the true field that needs to be in place. And I tell you, 20 years from now, our field will not be growing. No young people will be coming to our field. Young people will be going to tech companies, which is pretty cool. They will not be coming into our field. They will not be coming into theaters, and what a shame. So I ask to you all, what are the, and you don't have to answer it, what are the standards that you hold for your organization? And as representatives, because you all didn't inform these spaces. We, as women, we sit in a position, right, and we represent for that time period. So when we're there, and I've been there, how do you work for these spaces and hold these spaces to certain standards? And when you feel like that space is not filling that standard, when do we say, this organization is null and void? We do not need this. What else can we make and build? Or I'm going to take 50% of what this group created and merge this 25 and this 25 and this independent artist right here, and this is a new conglomeration of a board, of an SEC, of a, or SEC 2, or, you know, like the subcommittee, and the, how do we start to really think about these things that kind of off-center what we have centered, which was never centered?
Mm-hmm. Great. I'm going to just, that's a really profound statement and question. I'm going to give the panel an opportunity to address it. We have a lot of questions in the room and comments, after which we'll go to Liz, and then I'm just circulating, trying to make sure that we're fair with the hands in the air. It's a really profound question, and I'm just going to kind of jump in and say, you know, this regional theater movement, we talk about movement building at the top of the morning, came out of that, right? This was our protest against Broadway, right? And now look at where we stand, women in this room, not being able to be employed in the leadership of this protest. So I'll give the panel an opportunity if they so choose to address, and then let Liz, you're next.
First of all, I think there's a very profound role for executive search firms. No, in reality, we're called in for few of the roles that are actually available, right? I mean, a lot of the next roles you're going to be looking at, you're not going to be working with an executive search firm. But what we can do is start to develop relationships. And I'm going to put the onus on you guys. You've put a lot of it on us, and that's fair, but on you as well. Get to know us, Tell us your stories. We want to hear your stories. How do your skills translate? How do they relate? And you can do that through every way you present yourself. Your resume, your LinkedIn profile, your cover letter, which is not just a cover letter, it's an intensive letter of interest. It's your enthusiasm, really, and that's not something you have to dampen down. Why are you interested in this position, this specific position? Prepare yourself to the nth degree. Why this organization? Why this position? What can you bring to it? And then tell the story about what you've done and how it translates. You know, and that educates us. We don't know you yet, but we want to, right? So tell us your story so we can then tell your story.
Great, Liz.
I had a comment. It's Erin's comments are so powerful. It's hard to really organize one's thoughts after that. And I want to thank the panel for the extraordinary information you're sharing with us. What I've been thinking about is this. There is clearly, and I'll use the old word just because it comes to mind, there is no pipeline problem. I mean, there just really isn't. And I don't only speak for the young people that I'm privileged to train at the Yale School of Drama in directing, but the people I meet in the process of an admissions search, when I'm out in the field working and meeting young women and mid-career women who are creating work. There's spectacular talent, unbelievable self-discipline, and chops of a management as well as artistic nature. Whether or not you end up running, whether you have institutional theater experience in a worked TCG theater, or whether you've had to be an entrepreneurial director creating your own work, you've obviously honed the skills that should position you for positions in large institutions. One of the things that I have observed, and I'd love to talk to you about this question, is that over the many, many years of LORT, we've seen a shift in the way LORT theaters bring in the next generation. In the generation right before me, I would almost say the half generation right before me, which would have been the generation that came up in the 1970s. I came up in the 1980s, which is already 8 million years ago. But it was the generation before me who were moving into staff positions, staff associate artistic director positions, and they were directing. And it was very interesting that by the time I emerged from my own training, which was in the mid-1980s, those positions were drying up. Or they were shifting. Artistic directors were very reluctant to be giving positions to directors and sort of letting them pee on the carpet with their first reasonably budgeted shows. They felt the stakes were too high, it was too scary. And so they were looking for dramaturgs and other artists in the theater to take these staff positions so they wouldn't have to give directors roles as staff directors. I'm not sure which comes first, the lack of jobs or the lack of appetite that has emerged among directors of a certain, of my generation and after, who sort of, women I'm speaking of specifically, who said, the hell with the artistic director job, I don't want to spend all my time fundraising. I think that part of the problem is that many of those voices are folks who have not had an opportunity to work inside an institution like this. And that, a few women, and they're all women, have started to call me, artistic directors of regional theaters, and say, we have to change this. And how can we do it? And I've said, well, here's how you can do it. I want to help the next generation. I want to help the succession. I want to make this possible. I said, well, here's what you can do. You can give them a job. You can give them a salary. You can give them benefits. Give them lots of work to do. Throw them into educational outreach, whatever you need, but give them a chance to direct. Mm-hmm. And just beginning to happen. And it's extraordinary. And at tiny off Broadway theaters and at regional theaters. And I'm hoping, I want to talk to people, DCG folks and work people, and have a much bigger conversation about this. Mm-hmm. In one case, it was a cold call from Susan Booth at the Lion Theater, mm-hmm. who said, I want to do something about this. Mm-hmm. And later, it was Daniela Topol at Radstick. Mm-hmm. And you know, these are extraordinary folks who are prepared to walk the walk. And I think there are many, many more women artistic leaders who are prepared to do that as well. They need to have help and support, mm-hmm. Also from imaginative and creative boards to do that.
Is Carol done here?
She's coming tomorrow, and she's sitting on the, yes.
Oh, she's basically following up on what you just said, Liz. Carol Dunn from Northern Stage, and many of you probably know about this, has this thing called the Bold Initiative, which was funded by Helen Gurley Brown's Pussycat Foundation. Mm-hmm. And she's going to, and it's going to allow five female artistic directors to hire a female associate, and part of the demands of the grant are that they're exposed to all aspects of the organization, as well as they are must be given directing jobs. So it's a little bit of hope there, but she will be here to talk about this much more tomorrow.
Carol is on the final Pinnacle conversation, and it's a really incredible initiative. So.
Can I give my punchline?
A quick punchline, and then Debbie.
My quick punchline was only this. In that little narrative I just offered, I just would like to observe, every single person who made this happen was female. Mm-hmm. So there's really, including the funder we found to help us out at Rattlestick. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we really don't need to look any further.
Recognizing our histories, recognizing the institutions that are preventing women and people of color from rising, not only within theaters, but within other organizations, other parts of society. I mean, look at Congress, or don't look at Congress. And I think that sometimes having structure that is tied, you know, we're in a capitalist society, right? When you tie something to money, like sometimes that will get something to move in a way that it both and, you still want to have the conversations about the ethics of it and about, you know, institutionalized racism and the way that, you know, gender plays out in our society. But sometimes those more sort of mandated structures can get people to move in a way that can be faster and can actually then spark the conversation about the deeper work. So I think it really has to be both things together in order to move forward in a way that we'll hope, you know, hopefully see change in our lifetimes.
Laura, if I could just respond to Erin. I didn't want to lose that thread, which goes back a little bit. As with Liz, that's a really powerful statement that you made, and I want to. I'm kind of taking it in, and there are a couple of things I want to say about SDC. First of all, I don't think we're on SDC 2.0, but I do think SDC has changed a great deal in the last 10 years. I've been there for 10 years. And places change all the time, but very specifically, you know, SDC, for those who don't know, is a labor union. We're a union. We exist to make sure that the people who are union members get paid fairly, and that the employers fulfill their obligation, and we do the best we can, but which is pretty good a lot of the time. But 10 years ago, we were an organization who only fulfilled that very basic obligation. Did it well, but did never ask for demographic information. Did not feel it had a role in community engagement on any level beyond the bargaining table. It was the members, because we're a membership organization as a labor union, that actually said they wanted to change. And which is part of why I think they hired me, an unusual choice to run a labor union. I'm not a labor leader. I guess I am now. But because they wanted to have a more dynamic relationship with the field, and they wanted to begin to address some of the larger issues. At that time, didn't actually ask gender. The staff sort of guessed gender, you know, when filling out. So like really basic understanding of who the membership was and how they made their work and what they wanted and needed aspirationally beyond a good health plan and a pension. And today the organization is very highly engaged. And what the members want the union to be for them in this moment, which is a huge moment in the field, we are here to be. And, you know, we have board members in the room and a couple of committee members in the room, and I think we have a fair number of members in the room. But as I said, sort of the go back and do the work, we are trying to do more and more all the time, and we are your organization. So we work for the employers. We don't employ anybody, and we're not a dispatch union, which is, some days I'm glad about that, other days I wish I could dispatch people, but we're not a dispatch union, we're not a referral union. So the employers have complete control over who they hire. We have no say whatsoever in how people are hired. But we have a lot of influence, and we have some power. And so we should figure out how you want us to use it in this moment. So
well,
I just wanted to say that.
And I think I can get, maybe we keep them short, 4 questions in. I have this woman here, she's been waiting for a long while. And I'm trying to reach people who haven't spoken yet. So if you've spoken, I'm probably going to pass over you, and we have that conversation at dinner. Okay, then I have a woman here, and then 2 down front. Oh my God, you were ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm loving all the conversations in this room. I think it's really essential that we're having these as a collective of women that are trying to make it in our awesome industry. But what I'm finding is that the voice that's missing is the male, actually, because how else can we open the conversation and have those institutions realize that, you know, the research that's been done and all of these voices that are so strongly affected by how we're living in this, in our ecology, we need to be able to have those conversations.
So how do we then create allies, as particularly with white males, in order to educate and have great conversations that will then allow us to potentially have the opportunity to grow in the future?
I can tell you one quick thing. We'll let the panel address, but do, if you can, maybe to Cocktails for Change, because that's one of the central questions tonight, at Cocktails for Change. Kim, yes.
I actually was thinking that you were answering your own questions by using the word educate. I think, and I'm not a...
Can you stand up, Inika?
Sorry. That I felt like you were answering the question by using the word educate, that through relationships, not just here with all women, but with the others, whoever they are, by being there, by standing out, by having a conversation, by creating a great space like we did here today, that is a way of engaging the other in this conversation. I'm not an expert on how to do that, so I'm hoping that somebody else could talk to that, but I think we all have an obligation, if we see a problem, to address it, to confront it, to analyze it in a group with the ones who are on both ends of that problem, and then to come up with, collaboratively, come up with a solution. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This isn't a tit for tat, I hope. I think this is not like, we want your job. I don't think that's what anybody here is saying, but this is the conversation. How can we make this equitable for everybody so that we are standing next to each other as equals and actually push the field and the missions of this amazing field forward so that the humanity of it can continue existing.
Can I just speak to the allyship part real quick? Because we thought a lot about it in constructing and framing that term for the summit. And I'd love to talk to anybody else more about it. That the term male allies, we found to be too restrictive, that those who are fighting against women's rights are not just the men in the world, right? So we need gender allies, and we need gender allies because gender is more complex than what we're able to address right now. So in that, I think we have to make the case that what we are trying to achieve is not, at its core, putting more women on top. It is making the possibility for anybody to be up there.
Yeah. And increasing the pot, right? Really increasing the pot.
Yes, increasing the pot. But to say like that, it's in the fundamental sense of things, we don't want parity. We want equity. We want people who belong up there to be up there.
Yeah, let's talk to you.
Identifying as opposed to what we see when we see people. And so I'm very curious to see what that reveals for us internally, but I don't know of any sort of comprehensive study of that across the
world. I think Actors Equity's done some work in this area, but they're the only organization that I'm aware of.
We're going to wrap up, but we have a writer from HowlRound who actually did an article. Sarah's a little shy. But she actually wrote, if you could just quickly mention your article and maybe we could just point people, that will give you some insight on that really quickly, and then we'll go to Erica.
Thanks. This is a three-part series I'm doing on HowlRound. The second part just went up this week called Chronic Theater Makers, where I've been interviewing theater makers with chronic illness. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting because they have generated a lot of comments in like Facebook
that because I think these are important conversations, and I've already had people reach out to me about mental illness and other things that I think all fall into that realm. And I think it's an important conversation. Everyone's telling me, I wish I had heard this conversation when I was younger, turning out, and that is the reason why I wanted to do this.
Thank you.
So this is a comment, but I'd love to hear the panel's response. I feel like there's kind of an assumption in the room around that only directors can be artistic directors. And I feel like it connects to what you were saying about so many women at the sort of number two at the department head level. Certainly at my theater, almost every department head is a woman, and I feel like there's something to be said for people who are kind of on a leadership pipeline looking for any leadership opportunity that's available to them, and that those of us that are leading education departments and marketing departments, we're there partly because we want to build our leadership skills, and we hope that that gets sort of recognized and transferred up. And that I also think, as much as I totally think it's a very valuable thing to look at freelance directors, also I would say playwrights out there that could transfer their skills, that there's also something really valuable about folks that have chosen to kind of root themselves in an institution and lead a department or produce for the theater, be a literary manager, and really learn about kind of the institutional structure. And I hope that those skills are also valued as transferable upwards.
Thank you.
So 10,000 Things, we didn't use a search firm, and our search committee, transition committee, has like two board members on it. Like, I looked at my board and I was like, you guys will never be able to tell who's good. I think that's one reason there are search firms, because we say boards should search, but we believe that the artists and the staff should really be the primary movers in the search. Yes. They know what you do. It's basically to approve who they come up with. And I think I don't mean to totally dismiss search firms, but I think that by giving a voice to artists in your organization and staff and people who are really rooted in your community to contribute to the search, the need to pay people from the outside to come in is lessened, and there may be some creative possibilities in there. I don't think boards have to search. I think boards just have to approve the final hire, if I'm understanding. So there's a lot of play in there. You can mess around.
Hey, no, you use a fight word, Michelle. Let's go.
But what I'm trying to say, my biggest responsibility, I feel, as a search consultant, honestly, first of all, is to the talent. So that's an executive director. I don't do a lot of artistic. So that conversation, while it's fascinating, I don't feel like I can intelligently comment upon from my position. But I will tell you, like what I was saying before, our role is a lot of not so fun conversations in that initial kickoff, because we early and often challenge the boards / the ED serving the board / the search committee that shows up. And they are two stakeholders who have written two checks in the past 5 years that have basically covered most of the ops, and the board person on the board who you know the rest of them are kowtowing to, no offense to everybody, but we can see that, we see you. So we say to them, you know, that may be the first pass, but we are really being very disciplined within our business and our mind, particularly of saying no to that search team. Because here's what's going to happen. I'm going to do a lousy search for you. And then 6 months later, you're going to be pissed at me. And I can't have that. And I won't have that. And there's so many people out there. So we've become some people's favorite consultant for that in my world. And I am some people's least favorite consultant in my world, because I'm not interested in an all-white, all-male board search committee. In our searches, staff meets one-on-one with them, like the three or four finalists. Staff meets as a group. We script the questions. So it's the same. Then they have time to talk their own questions. We make them do a cocktail party. We make them do a dinner. And I'm not saying like these are the answers to everything, but I'm saying
I think putting that power into the people who on the front line are going to deal with this person every single day. I don't care if you raise you $1 million. If your marketing director quits, your development director quits, and the interns hate them, your organization is not going to work. So it's about fit, it's about action, and we're trying to really listen to that and retrain the board. This last point, I hear boards all the time say, well, we want this many years of experience and we want an MFA, and automatically that wipes out a large percentage of people. Not just MFA, whatever the specific thing is. And we are saying all the time now, why? Yeah. Tell me why you want an MFA. Do you even know what an MFA will bring you? You really don't. And if they can't articulate why they want an MBA or an MFA or what they want, why they want it, how many years of experience? We want 10 to 12. That's pretty specific. Why 10 to 12? Like, why not 20 to 11? So we are really pushing back, and I'm saying it in a much more like cheeky way than I would ever to anybody. We are very gentle with them, and we are very, you know, supportive. We want them to learn as well, because a lot of them don't know. They've been filling these positions for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, and they've served on other boards. And it all just goes around in a circle. And we start to try to push those buttons and say, seriously, tell me what an MFA is going to bring your organization right now. Yeah. What is it that's going to do that? So that's just my thing. So that's what we're trying to do.
Jenna, you know, it's interesting because we've been talking about, in essence, you know, the body here has been saying to the body here, you know, where is your fight in our movement? Where's the activism? And so as a search committee, when you say, do you understand, what exactly is the MFA doing? What do you need the 12? You're actually challenging hiring.
Yeah. Yeah.
You are challenging hiring. Yeah. Yes, it may seem like nothing, but that's a big step towards our movement. We have to take one more. I'm so sorry.
Wait, and I think there's a clarification.
Yes, one second. I'm just going to give a last instruction. Let's take one more from the audience. We're going to bounce back to the panel. And then we have to take a big group picture and then move this on to dinner because we want to stay in accordance with a little bit of colonial thing, which is time. Wait here and then final word from the audience. Yes, Joe.
I think you need to be really careful because you're the both ends, you know, issue. You are reacting about boards looking at behavior that is the result of the way that boards have been treated and constructed. And you talk about the need for change in all these other areas. There needs to be a major change in how we think about what boards can offer and how they are constructed and what their roles and responsibilities are. And until you commit to saying that we have to build different kinds of boards to deal with the different situations that we are facing from the world, from, you know, what's happening in the field, I think you have to be really careful about saying, oh, boards are just there to a rubber stamp.
No,
because that is absolutely the lowest common denominator of thinking about boards. And I hope that we can think much bigger and much more generatively about what boards can offer.
My name is Lisa Cortez. I'm a woman leader.
There's
so much passion in this room right now. I can feel it. My stomach, my heart's racing. We're all excited. It's a good time to get dinner and some cocktails. I have a girl crush on every single person who's spoken here. I have two things I wanted to say. One, I want to pick up on what Liz said. I had an MFA directing program at the theater school at DePaul University in Chicago. There is no pipeline problem. There's a pipeline clog. We're constipated, actually.
Yeah.
And it's at about the 10-year mark. I notice my women directors and directors of color get out. They make a good run at it for about 10 years, and then they need a job that can pay them so they can have
families or get married or do something else. So that's actually the point 10 years out that I went into teaching in academia, because I needed some kind of institution. So we have to just look at that 10-year mark. It may not be right out of school. Look at 10 years out. And then secondly, I wanted to pick up on what Erin was saying. I am proud to be one of the founding members of the Latinx Theater Commons. And I want to say that that was in reaction specifically to what you're saying, which is, what can we do? Can we stop knocking at the door of the institutions that are there, of the Lord system or the whatever systems that are in place? How can we mobilize our collective resources as Latinx theater makers to make stuff happen and to amplify the field? Mm-hmm. It is possible, and you're absolutely right. Sometimes I encourage us all to think outside of the box and think about other, and that is because of the support of Arts Emerson and HowlRound that gave us infrastructure, but it's because they were already thinking outside of the box. So we said, we're thinking outside of the box. How can we work together to think outside of the box and create new systems and strategies to amplify the work?
All right, well, I want to thank everybody who's live streaming, and thank our panel. Just a couple of things. As Akita said, we want to get a photo. As Michelle said earlier, we're not a pipeline. We're the irrigation system that will make this field grow. So let's take a picture and send out to some funders to say fungus.
We're going to try to put a row of chairs up against the green, and some brave people might stand on those chairs, and then some people stand in front of those people, and then some brave people sit on the floor.
Wait, one more note.
One more note.
For those of you who are staying for dinner, can you bring your chair back